Hello, I'm so happy to be here today and have the chance to present for a second time this year in front of the VMAC audience. My session for today will be storage at the edge to node vSAN cluster for the win. My name is Teodora Hristov and I'm working as a technical marketing manager at VMware. And I do specialize in two node cluster and stretch cluster configurations. And I would really like to share a few highlights before we start that session for today. And the thing that I want to emphasize on is the fact that the two node cluster represents a specific vSAN, a specific small vSAN configuration with minimal number of hosts required, which is the key ingredient for its flexibility and effectiveness in a broad variety of use cases. As we can see later on in our presentation, the two-node cluster has two nodes that are deployed at the remote site and one witness host or appliance that can be deployed at the remote site or at the main data center. Before we go on with the two-node cluster configuration, I would like to take a quick look at the normal cluster configuration and give some details around the terminology and objects and components that can be found inside the vSAN storage software layer. So the vSAN data store is an object store, meaning that all of the data that is stored on vSAN is gathered into groups. Those will be the object types. For example, we can have object type like VMDK or VM home namespace or VM swap file. All the snapshot deltas and the snapshot themselves are also vSAN objects. Each object can grow up to 700 gigabytes. We can apply different policies on that object, and we can apply different policies to those objects. For example, in a normal cluster, we can have failures to tolerate of 1 or 2, and we can have a rule of rate till 1 or 5 or 6. But in terms, when we speak about two node cluster, we can only apply a mirroring policy where we have a failure to tolerate of 1 and rate 1, because we have only two nodes and we will have the witness host that will only store metadata. Again, as you can see from the diagram, we have, for simplicity, we have picked only one object, which will be our VMDK. And because the size of this VMDK is 700 gigabytes, we have split those that object into three different components. And each object has an entire replica on each host. And of course, we have the witness component. So going forward, we will be speaking a bit about what are the companies that are choosing to use remote offices or branch offices license, which is the license that is required for two-node cluster. And we'll dive a bit more into the details. As I mentioned, the two-node cluster configuration has been created to service a specific requirements of the retail companies with big number of small retail sites or branches. It is also a preferred choice for small companies or startups that don't need many hosts for their data center and don't want to have a big upfront investment. There are, of course, some challenges that those companies are meet on the way of their robo-site virtualization, and some of them are the ones that you can see on the slide. This is because in terms of software and hardware, there is never a one-size-fits-all option. This is why when we speak about remote offices and branch offices, we do speak about two-node cluster and small configurations. The first challenge is the first challenge that a company of that size and that type of business might meet is the fact that often there is no IT staff to take care of the hardware and software lifecycle at the edge, at the remote site, meaning that whenever there is an issue or a problem or the hardware or software needs to be upgraded or changed, there should be a person that should go at the remote site and take care of that issue. And often this is a very lengthy and complex process. This is why companies that have a lot of remote offices and branch offices do search for an easy option for a software lifecycle and hardware lifecycle as well. The other thing is that the robo sites usually have a low budget dedicated for IT infrastructure. Big companies usually have low budget dedicated for the remote site software and hardware equipment, and they are searching for cost-saving options that can fit their needs. They also have small branches do need small clusters with 2 to 4 nodes on site to bring storage and compute services closer to where the data is generated. Again, they are searching for specific small configuration to serve their specific needs. They also have limited space. There's often insufficient server space at the edge. The servers are not located in a data center, which is related to the next challenge that those companies are facing, and this is the security challenge. Because as I mentioned, those servers are not located in a data center. They are often deployed without thinking through the security implication. And usually the physical security at the edge location is not very strict since there are no specific restrictions in terms of physical access like there are in the data center. And the server might also be exposed to serious climate changes, vibrations, and data breaches. This is why companies are looking for a secure option for their remote deployments. And lastly, the network connectivity might not be the best because those remote branches or offices might be located in a place where the network infrastructure is old or there's a legacy network infrastructure, the speed of the network might be slow, so this is another problem that companies are looking to solve. Companies can overcome these obstacles by implementing the two-node cluster configuration at the edge, because two-node allows for the software to be centrally managed, it has low price and can be scaled on demand. And of course, it offers security options like encryption and simple management. And finally, let's talk about the two-node architecture in details. As you can see on the screen, we have two hosts that are deployed at the edge location that are directly connected between each other, and then we have a connection layer 3 routed network connection with the witness component, with the witness host that is deployed at the central site, where we also have our Active Directories, DNS, platform services controller, and of course the vCenter management and operations manager. Very important to highlight here is the fact that each node is configured as a fault domain. So this means that we can apply a mirror data protection, and this will result into two complete replicas residing on each host from the two node cluster. So in case that something happens to one of those clusters, to one of those hosts, the VM can be vMotion to the alternate host, and this will ensure its redundancy. There's a dedicated witness host or appliance that again can be deployed at the central site, and this witness host or appliance will be serving as a tiebreaker in case of a failure scenario. And it will be it will store only small metadata components. There will be no data that will be stored at that witness appliance or host. Of course, we'll speak about that in details, but we can have a dedicated witness for each two node cluster, or one shared witness for up to 64 clusters, which is a very useful feature that has been introduced recently with vSAN. Another two-node architecture that can be deployed is the one that you can see on the screen, where we have the two-node cluster deployed at the remote site and the witness appliance or host deployed at the remote site as well. And we also have a connection to the main data center. We will have the option to apply storage policy to this specific configuration. And something very important to highlight here, the witness host is deployed at the two node cluster site, but outside of the two node cluster, and it should be part of the same vCenter. A two node vSAN cluster with vSAN robo licensing is an affordable way to provide storage and compute resources at the remote sites. The simplicity and cost has been driven down even further by support of directly connecting a two-node vSAN environment. And of course, this bypasses the need of redundant 10 gigabit switching needed to pass vSAN traffic between hosts, and separates the witness traffic so that the witness can be contacted using the existing switching hardware at the remote office. In scenarios that have dozens, hundreds, or even thousands of remote sites, this simplified arrangement can offer dramatic cost savings. The vSAN 2 node cluster accommodates layer 2 and layer 3 topologies as well. Multiple remote locations can be connected to the same central site, meaning that we can deploy more than one two-node cluster and connected to a dedicated witness host or appliance, or we can have one shared witness host or appliance, and we can connect it to multiple up to 64 two-node clusters. Additionally, vSAN Robo Edition licensing has no host limit restriction. There is only a restriction of the number of VMs that may run in a site. A maximum of 25 VMs per site robo license is required, and any multiple of 25 VMs will require another robo license. Again, as I mentioned, both hosts in the remote office are storing data. The witness in the central office is storing metadata. And we have requirement for 500 round-trip latency connection and a 1.0 megabit per second bandwidth from host to the witness. We also have the option to enable deduplication and compression as well as encryption. Of course, additional two node clusters can be seamlessly added, as I previously mentioned. The two node cluster can also be converted into a normal one, as long as we add more than two hosts. there is a specific guide that customers can use and can easily convert the two-node cluster into a normal one if there's a need to do so. Another very important advantage of the two-node configuration is the fact that customers can easily scale their software and hardware deployments while they're when there's a need of a new remote or branch office to be created and to use software and hardware services. We have again Active Directory, DHCP, DNS, and print servers available, as well as the option to enable templates and VDI. As I promised, I will cover in more details the shared witness host or appliance option that has been introduced with vSAN 7 update 1. It delivers greater efficiency to this topology through the ability to use the same witness host virtual appliance at the central site for multiple two-node sites. This greatly reduces the number of physical resources needed at the central site and can result in extraordinary level of savings for large numbers of two-node branch or office deployments. For example, a topology with 30 remote sites would have previously needed 240 gigabytes of RAM at the central site for the witness host appliances, but using a shared witness model would only require 16 gigabytes. We have also introduced an extra large option, size option, in order to accommodate the bigger cluster, the bigger number of cluster deployments. And it is always recommended to, before we deployed a witness appliance, to think through the requirements about the witness appliance. There is a very useful two-node guide that you can find at core.vmware.com, and you can find also a lot of different useful information. I'll mention the link later on during this session, so stay tuned. And as we mentioned, the two-node vSAN architecture has proven to be a great solution for organizations that have a large number of small branch offices or retail sites, and it helps them reduce operational and technical overhead as well. Speaking about the witness shared witness option, there's a new UI option to manage the witness host appliance, and we're going to take a look at a short demo to see how easy it is to deploy and mount more than one two-node cluster to a shared witness. As we can see, we have two-node clusters that have been connected to the existing shared witness. Those are the cluster 01 and cluster 02. And then we have the host that is in blue, which is our shared witness appliance. We have the option to connect up to 64 two-node cluster to a single shared witness. So what we're going to do is to connect this cluster 03 to our existing shared witness. So we have completed the cluster basics because we have enabled vSphere DRS, vSphere HA, and vSAN, of course. What we're going to do next is to add hosts using the cluster quick start. We can select our two hosts that will be part of the two-node cluster, and we'll leave the third one, which is our shared witness host, for the configuration later on. We will finish the process, there will be some health checks that vSAN will perform in order to see that everything is configured correctly. And then we'll go ahead and configure the cluster itself. We'll click on configure. Here we're going to see, we'll go with the configuration of the network for later. We're going to save it for later. We'll click on next. We will select the deployment type and we'll change it to two-node vSAN cluster. We'll click on next. And then we're going to claim our disks. We have a suggestion given by vSAN. We'll go with the suggested configuration. Here we're going to select our shared witness appliance. We'll click next. And then we can review and finish the process. After the configurational health checks are successful, we can see that we have introduced new cluster into our vCenter, and we have connected the same disk cluster to as a third cluster to our shared witness appliance. This is how easy it is to use these options. Our customers are also are already taking advantage of this new option. Going forward, we'll speak a bit about the networking. As we can see, we have the direct connection that will be a 10 gigabit crossover cable between the two hosts that are deployed at the remote office. And then we have a connection to 1 gigabit management switch to the witness host or appliance. And something very important that I want to highlight here is the fact that we have a witness traffic separation, which means that the witness traffic is completely separated from the vSAN data traffic. The vSAN data traffic can flow between the two nodes on the direct connect. The witness traffic can be routed to the witness site over the management network, and there is no need to support multicast traffic on the vSAN back-to-back network because you don't need to consider multicast on the management network because the witness traffic is unicast. Then we can see a little bit more details about the VM kernel configurations. As you can see, the vSAN Direct Connect will need two different VM kernels for vSAN and for vMotion. And for vSAN, this will be VM kernel 2. And for vMotion, this will be VM kernel 3. vMotion is needed whenever we have a failure of one of the two nodes and we need to migrate the VM on the alternate host. And again, we have VM kernel 1 for the witness and VM kernel 0 for ESXi management. There's another great option that saves a lot of time, and this is the new feature that has been recently introduced with vSAN 7U2, U1. That simplifies the configuration process for stretch cluster and two-node configurations by allowing the user to specify if the default gateway used by vSAN should be overridden with different IP address that should be used. This, of course, allows us to quickly identify and correct misconfigurations. There is an improved visibility of the current setting. Of course, it is easy to be modified and to eliminate the configuration via CLI. And of course, we should mention the encryption option that can be enabled with the single click. We have only data at rest encryption available for two-node configurations, and there is something very important to highlight here is the fact that this service is a per cluster setting, and supports hybrid all-flash shared cluster and two-node. But being a port cluster setting means that each two-node cluster, the encryption for each two-node cluster should be enabled separately. It works with all vSAN features, and it also works with KMIP compliant key management systems. As I already mentioned, if you go to core.vmware.com and search for two-node configuration, you'll find a lot of interesting information. Another interesting and useful tool will be the vSAN interactive infographic that you can see on this slide. We have some diagrams that are showing what will happen if a two-node cluster, if there's a failure inside the vSAN two-node cluster. If you go to stretch cluster and pick the two-node option, you will be able to take a look what will happen if one of the hosts fails. What we're going to see right now is the some common failure scenarios and what will happen if a drive fails or a host fails inside the two-node cluster configuration. Again, we have our two nodes that are deployed at the remote site and the vSAN witness appliance or host shared or dedicated. It depends on the customer's preferences. So first, if one of the capacity devices fails, then we'll simply move the VM object to the alternate capacity device if there is one. If an entire vSAN host or we have only one capacity device fails, well, in this case, we will simply vMotion the VM to the alternate site. In case the other host fails, but we have brought back the first one to operational, well, we will migrate our VM to the first one. And lastly, if the witness host or appliance fails, in this case, we won't have any impact on the VM running state. The VM will stay on the on the same host, and it will be using the data available until the host is brought back to operational. It is something that I want to emphasize on here is the fact that we have a very easy option to change the witness inside the vSAN UI. So we do recommend to simply go and change the witness in case there's a problem with the witness appliance or host. And we also recommend to do not upgrade or snapshot or vMotion the witness. We can simply go ahead and use the UI and change it. And again, why robot customers should use a two-node cluster? Well, we have spoke for 25 minutes about the different advantages of this configuration, but again, it is cost-efficient, easy to deploy and maintain. It helps customers with the life cycle of their software. And finally, it is a secure and very useful way to organize and manage your remote locations. I hope that this information was useful for you. Thank you for being with me today. And again, my name is Teodora Hristov, and in case you have some questions, I will be glad to answer them later on. Thank you. Have a nice day.